at our church, we say this. I want you to say it out loud.
The main thing is to keep the main thing, the main thing.
Okay, now, what is the chief end and duty of a pencil, or what is the main thing of a pencil? Okay, when a pencil doesn't write, what do you do? No, you try to sharpen it first. Then if it won't sharpen, you throw it away. Okay, now another thing. What is the chief end and duty of a watch? Okay. What is the chief end and duty of an automobile? To transport. Now, here's the big question. And we do this every Sunday at our church, because I don't want our people to forget it. And when I say every Sunday, every now and then we miss it, but we ask this question. What is the chief end and duty of a man? And when we give the answer to that, then we say the main thing is to keep the main thing, the main thing. What is the chief end and duty of man? And you read the whole thing out loud. What is the chief end and duty of man? On enjoy, because the word love has lost its meaning in America. When last did you spend 30 minutes with God and not ask Him for anything? Just enjoy Him. Now, let me say this to you. Enjoying God is not enjoying church. It's not enjoying the saints. It's not enjoying the Bible. It's not enjoying the blessings of God. Enjoying God is enjoying God. And there's one thing I know about everything that we enjoy. When we enjoy something, the time goes real quickly. I drive to the church early in the morning because I go down there to have to do my waiting with God. I don't even like to have the windshield wipers on in the car. They're making a noise. There's something wonderful about stillness because God speaks in a still, small voice and he comes that way. I have found that journaling is the greatest thing I've ever done in my life. There's hardly ever a day that goes by I don't do a lot of journaling, and I'll explain that to you either in this message or in the next message. But what he was trying to tell us last night was this right here, as I understand what he was trying to get across to us. And when something doesn't perform its main thing, it needs to be adjusted or got rid of. And so I'm going to ask you this question, and then I want you to say after that, the main thing is to keep the main thing, okay? Okay, what is the chief end and duty of man? So what I would like to do this morning is this. I want to speak to you. I feel like this was a confirmation on the message I'm to bring to you this morning on rivers. Mary and Martha, Jesus was in their home one time. And Jesus made this statement concerning what Mary was doing. Mary was sitting at his feet, listening to his word, And Martha came in and said, Jesus, how come you left? Mary is leaving me to do all the serving. Will you tell her to get up and come do all the serving? And this was Jesus' answer to Martha. And I really believe that it's the answer to the church today. Martha, you're careful and troubled about many things. Only a few things are needful. And then he narrowed it down. He said, only one thing is needful. One thing is needful. And Mary has chosen that part. It will not be taken from her. What was she doing? She was sitting at Jesus' feet, and she was listening to his word. Now, my whole ministry is built around this little chart I'm going to put up here next. There were two little boys that were incorrigibles, absolutely incorrigible. Nobody could help them at all. And so they always end up taking little boys like that to the preacher. So the preacher said, I think I can help them, bring them. So they brought these two little boys to the preacher, and he sat the younger one in the outer office and took the older one into his office. And sat him down, looked at him and said to him, son, where is God? Well, the little boy looked at him and didn't answer a word, so in a minute or two, the preacher raised his voice a decibel or two and said, son, where is God? The boy didn't say a word. So the preacher tried it one more time. Son, where is God? Well, at that, the little boy got up and dashed out of the office, grabbed his younger brother, and headed out into the parking lot. His little brother said, what's wrong? He said, God's missing and they're blaming us. Now, folks, you won't laugh so much when you realize that the world is saying God is missing and they're blaming us and they ought to blame us because we're the people from whom God comes. Here's another story. I'm trying to reinforce the message last night. A man bought a canary. The reason most people buy canaries is so they can sing. Well, he put the canary in the cage and the bird didn't sing, so he went back to see the owner of the pet store and said, the canary I bought from you is not singing. So the owner thought for a little bit. He said, have you got a perch? He said, no, I don't have a perch. He said, if you buy one of my perches, that bird will sing. So the guy shelled out some money and bought a nice perch, put it in the cage, and the bird sat on the perch, but he didn't sing. So after two more days, he went back to see the pet store owner. And the pet store owner said, did you put the perch in? Yeah. Did the bird sit on the perch? Yeah. I don't understand. The boy said, I've got it. Have you got a swing? He said, no, I don't have a swing. He said, you buy one of my swings. And he said, the bird will sing. So he bought him a swing, put it in the cage, and the bird sat on the perch and swung on the swing, and he still didn't sing. So he went back to the pet store owner another time and said, and the bird didn't sing. He said, did he sit on the perch? Yeah, did he swing on the swing? He said, I've got it. I really have it this time. Do you have a mirror? He said, no, I don't have a mirror. He said, you burn one of my mirrors, and that bird will sing. So he bought a mirror and put it in the cage, and the bird sat on the perch, swung on the swing, looked in the mirror, and still didn't sing. Well, in desperation, he went back to see pet store owner one more time, and pet store owner said, did he sit on the perch? Yeah. Did he swing in the swing? Yeah. Look in the mirror? Yeah. He said, I got it. Have you got a ladder? He said, no, I don't have a ladder. He said, if you buy a ladder, that bird will sing. So he bought a ladder and put it in the cage, and the bird sat on the perch, and swung on the swing, looked in the mirror, climbed up and down the ladder, and finally dropped over dead. Well, he went back to see the pet store owner, and the pet store said, I really don't understand it. He said, do you have any clue at all why that bird died? And he said, well, just before he died, while he was laying on his back, he said this, why didn't you use some of your money to buy bird seed? Now listen, I want you to hear, he shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Spiritual bird seed is what proceeds out of the mouth of God. Conferences and books like mine are swings and mirrors. And what we preachers are always trying to sell you is another book, another conference, another sermon, another tape, another something else. And I tell you something, you never have the answer till you hear from God. When Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, he was not talking about the Bible. He could have used the word scriptures very easily, because he used the word scriptures all the time. He was saying, man shall not live by bread alone, but he must live by what I say to him. Now, this is a very important year in my life. In the next 8 months, I will have been in the ministry 40 years. I'll have been married 40 years, in my present church 25 years. I tell you what I've discovered. One sentence from God does more for people than 100 of my sermons. And I've been where I am long enough to give them 100 of my sermons. I'm dead serious. I see people come alive when they hear from God one time. I mean, something happens to them. When God speaks and they hear and they listen. Okay, I want to get to my message now. And I want to speak on one of the ways of God is the way of rivers. God was like rivers. He starts the Bible with a garden and a river and ends the Bible with a city and a river. All the way through the Bible, there are rivers up and down and out through the Bible. And do you have the John 7:37 thing there? Okay, we're going to use this. Here's a scripture. Here's my favorite scripture on rivers. Would you read that out loud, please? Christianity is. Look, let me just share with you. When I started the ministry 40 years ago, the church I was in, or the church that I knew, was only fighting two evils. They were fighting drinking and gambling. Most of the stuff we're fighting today didn't even have names back then. We didn't even know they existed. Now look, with all of the efforts of the Church of Jesus Christ for 40 years, the dung pile is getting bigger and deeper and bigger and deeper, and all of our efforts have done nothing to do away with evil.
Amen.
I'm sure that you've heard of the story, but I'm going to tell it for those that haven't. In mythology, the Superman of mythology was a guy called Hercules, and they gave him Herculean tasks. And one of the tasks they gave him was to clean the Aegean stables. They hadn't been cleaned, and they were full of you-know-what about that day. So he got him a shovel and went to work. And he dug out some hair, took it out in a wheelbarrow and dumped it, and had a little rejoicing because there was a hole here. Then he went over to dig over here. And while he was digging over here, that hole filled up and got a little deeper. And what he saw was this. With all the work that he could do, he went out doing the horses. They were doing it faster than he could get rid of it. And he realized, listen, if the Church of Jesus Christ hasn't woken up to the fact that as dung diggers, the horses are doing it faster than we can get rid of it. I mean, we should be crying, we shouldn't be laughing. I'm telling you, we're losing. So this is what Hercules did. Hercules noticed that there was a river running north of the city. And he used all of his energy to dig a channel to the river. And when the river ran through the stables, the river cleaned out everything that he could never clean out, so that the Jesus in us can flow together. And that's what a church ought to be, a whole bunch of streams flowing together into a mighty river. People who are connected to Christ, but we are wasting our energies digging dung. Let's get Christ loose in us, through us, to other people. Let me just go over this. Integrating the tributary is not discarding the truth that you already have. And it's not taking the new truth as the answer to everything. But when God sends something new into your life, it is the process of understanding why God has sent a particular truth our way and how we are to adjust our lifestyles. Something to your life, it's going to disturb your lifestyle. There's going to be turbulence. You cannot be the same. See, a lot of people do not want to receive new truth, because when you receive a new revelation of God, a new truth about God, it's going to cause turbulence. Now, it causes turbulence in churches, and it causes turbulence in your own individual life, and the turbulence is caused in your life. You need to prepare for the fact that there's going to be a shake-up in your life. And we worship comfort in America. We don't want to be disturbed. We live in our comfort zone. And God comes along, as somebody said last night, to afflict the comfortable. And he afflicts us, and he's going to stir us up with this new truth. Hey, a new truth that doesn't change your life is not a truth. It's only knowledge in your head. When God sends something into your life, it's going to adjust the way you live, the way you think, the way you do, in some way. By the way, let me ask you a question. When was the last time you did something for the first time for the sake of Jesus Christ? And when last did he add something to your life? When last was there a tributary into your life that enriched your life and broadened your life and made your life a fuller expression of Jesus Christ? Now, there are all kinds of turbulence, and I've just listed some of them there. Listen, some of you are Baptists here. I'm a Baptist. And God sends the new truth of the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and you've heard all your life stuff against this. There's bound to be confusion in your life. There's bound to be a shaking up. But see, what a lot of people do, because they don't want the turbulence, they resist the truth and keep it out. They say, I don't want anything to do with it, rather than go through the turbulence. And sometimes it's very, very heavy turbulence. Sometimes you're asked to leave the church because of it. And I could go on with the other truths that God sends into our lives. They shake us up individually, and sometimes they shake us up socially. Now, expect turbulence. But after turbulence, there comes a bigger, better, fuller life. A greater. expression of the life of Jesus Christ. Now, I want to give you three warnings. Lots of people get caught up in an eddy. And I want to warn you against eddies. Yeah, an eddy is something that spins violently and gets nowhere. See, here's the river, and into your life comes a tributary. Do not get caught up in arguments. Do not get caught up in defending a truth or promoting a truth. Leave that up to God. In my opinion, Baptists are now caught up in the eddy of defending the Bible. And they're spinning viciously, wasting their energies, killing each other over defending. We don't have to defend the Bible. The best way to defend the Bible is to live it. There have been 1,000 eddies over the baptism and the filling of the Holy Ghost. What it means, listen to me. One thing I have come to see, that a person who is filled or baptized with the Holy Ghost doesn't get into arguments about him.
Glory.
You're not going to waste your time arguing about him. You'll be filled with the love of God and compassion for those that disagree with you. And you don't have to defend the truth. You just need to live it. And you remember that. So the first danger, listen. When eddies come your way into your church, into your home group, and things like that, don't get caught up in an eddy. Don't get caught up in arguments and defending. People burn up in these places because their energies are burned up and they don't have time to hear from God anymore. My experience has been this. And I forgot to call your attention when I talked about the center of the river. The channel of the river of God is a continuing personal relationship with God. And people who are in a continuing personal relationship with God can stand the addition of any tributary in their lives. And they're able to stay in the channel. Okay, put up the next one for me. The second thing that I want to warn you against is getting caught in an oxbow. There's a town in Louisiana called Falls River, Louisiana. It used to be the Mississippi River. It's no longer the Mississippi River. It looks like a river, but it's not the river. It's now an Oxbow Lake. An Oxbow Lake is where the river used to flow. It's the way God used to do things. But God's chosen not to do it that way anymore. But we were blessed that way. Now look, there's one thing I've noticed about this group in here, and two other people have noticed it. By and large, we're an over 40 group. I mean, they're, as I'm looking on, I can hardly spot anybody that even looks under 40. Now listen, because God blessed us in a certain way doesn't mean that God's going to use this way with the younger generation. And if we are hell-bent on having it like it used to be, in whatever group we're in, we miss God and get stuck in an oxbow. My son and I were discussing on this trip that we've been on, why do the movements of God shut down? And I think the movements of God shut down because people focus on the movement itself rather than on God and begin to worship the aspects of the movement. And when we do that, God says, I can't bless that anymore. So let me warn you, don't get stuck. Just be in the flow of God. If God decides not to use something anymore, I'm going to move away from this pulpit what I'm about to say because it's almost sacrilegious in this auditorium. And those of you that understand this, I am personally of the belief that God's not using Sunday school in its present form much anymore. Now, I want the roof to drop in on the wrong people. This is the building that Sunday school built. This is the house, this whole place Sunday school built. Listen, when we begin to worship a method, God takes his blessing off of it. Okay, the third danger in the river. We get stuck in the shallows. I am amazed at the number of people that are not going to church anymore. They've been caught in so much turbulence and other things. I'm really amazed at the number of people who just dropped out. And they've decided to tie up on the bank of the river and just watch what God is doing from the bank of the river, but not in, become involved anymore because they've been hurt so much. I wouldn't hesitate to bet that half the people in here have been in a church split. I can't get over the number of people that are just saying, hey, I made a trip the other day out to New Mexico and I saw people I used to know and they're saying, hey, I'm just not going to church anymore. I'm tired. So there are all kinds of reasons, and I want to urge those of you that are tied up on the bank, or you might still belong to a church and you might still go, but in reality you're tied up on the bank, you're not involved anymore because of past experiences. And you get back into the fellowship of God, and you get active with the people of God, so that together we can become a river of living waters in America, bringing healing everywhere to the people of the world. Okay, put up the next one. Now, if I gave you a sheet of paper that looked like this, could you fill it out? Could you tell the tributaries of God added in your life? Say, at this juncture in my life, God this. At this juncture of my life, God did this. This juncture of my life, God did this. See, as we walk with God, He's continually adding things to our life. I'm indebted to this sermon. My son gave me the first part of it. And this last part, the basis of it, I got from Richard Foster. But I feel like it's so far, so right on, that I want to share it with you. And Richard Foster says there are five basic religious tributaries in America, and I want you to look at them for just a minute, if you would, with me. Five basic tributaries that are in the stream of God in America. There's the evangelical tributary, the holiness tributary, the charismatic tributary. You'll recognize those because people have those names on churches. Then the social justice tributary and the contemplative tributary. Now, I believe what Richard Foster says is true. What God is doing today is causing these five streams to flow together. Now, if you look at the church in America, we are exactly the opposite of a river. Instead of tributaries becoming a river, a river has become tributaries. And we have divided from one another, and so the evangelical tributary has gone off and split into 10,000 different streams. We're actually in the reverse of a river. And I believe that what God wants us to do today is to bring us back so we can have a full life. Let me describe these to you. And here's the question. There are two questions I want to ask you. Number one is, which one was Jesus? And number two is this. And I want you to listen very carefully, because I want to get you to express it by standing up. Which one of these tributaries do you need the most in your life right now in order to become the kind of person that God wants you to be? Most Southern Baptists are evangelicals. I spoke at Asbury College the other day, and they have written across the top of the chapel, Holiness unto the Lord. The Methodists came out of the holiness tradition. I'm not sure they're in it anymore, but they came out of the holiness tradition. If you went to a Quaker church, you might sit down for 15 minutes and there wouldn't be any noise at all. We'd be doing what he said last night. Contemplatives are people who learn to listen to God. Most contemplatives today are found in the Roman Catholic Church or in the Episcopalian Church. And you can't find them amongst evangelicals because they don't have time to listen to God. They're active. They're burning up for God. Now, the social justice people, for instance, What do I mean by this? The social justice people are like Salvation Army. They're down here helping the poor. They're out on the front lines with the needy. They're doing good works just for the sake of doing good works, acts of mercy. When holiness is defined in terms of the length of your dress or the length of your hair or the amount of lipstick that you wear, holiness is corrupted. Holiness is basically an inner thing, not an outer thing. Now, it has outer manifestations. But see, we have taken holiness and made it something outward. The evangelical stream has been corrupted by forcing people to receive Christ long before they were ready, picking the fruit so we could get notches in our gun. Every one of these streams has been corrupted. Now, I want to show you from my understanding, and if I'm wrong, you can enrich me after the service with help. But I want to show you what I consider to be the great contributions of each one of these streams, And you'll see that we need them all. Put it up for me, please, sister. Okay. Now, the evangelical scream emphasized two things. Would you just let me go over this with you? Take a minute and read it, because I'm just going to be fighting you. You're not going to be listening while you're reading it. The evangelical scream emphasized two things. The study of Scripture and evangelism, and I should have put missions there. Now, if you've ever been to a Baptist church, you'll know the important things in a Baptist church are how many people attended Sunday school and how many people they've baptized. Why? Because that is where they put their emphasis. And on missions, how much money do we give to mission? Now, the holiness thing, I'm talking about them in their rightness. And God only knows that the whole church in America today needs a shot in the holiness stream. I mean, we need an infusion of holiness into our church life. But they emphasize right relationships. They're saying, a man can't be right with God who is wrong with his wife. A man can't be right with God who refuses to forgive other people. They talk about right relationships and the fruits of the Spirit. The charismatics, I think, have added, from my point of view, two great things. The praise of God. They make God exciting. And they want to, they praise God, and they're teaching us how to praise God. And then they have emphasized the gifts of the Spirit. The social justice people are acts of mercy. Let me tell you what an act of mercy basically is. It's doing something for somebody, whether they deserve it or not, and doing it for them, whether they'll ever turn to your point of view or not. It's just being good because people are needy and God's good and you do good to people. It's feeding the hungry man who won't work sometimes. And it's care for the poor and downtrodden. Pure religion. Oh, I ran into the most exciting thing. I've never seen it before. A James 1:27 ministry in Chattanooga, day before yesterday. This guy started a James 1:27 ministry, and a James 1:27 ministry is caring for the widows. Yes, that's all he does in his ministry, is care for the widows. I asked him, what do you mean care for the widows? Well, I fix their doors, unplug their toilets, take them shopping, and then the spiritual part of it with. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction. Keep oneself unspotted from the world. It's that kind of thing. Then the contemplate, now, is knowing God himself, fellowship with God, and the meditation of Scripture. Let me explain something to you. You better understand the difference between the meditation of Scripture and the study of Scripture. You use your left brain to study Scripture, you use your right brain to meditate. Listen, let me say something to you. The author of the Scriptures lives inside of you. He is the best explainer of the Scripture. He can tell you what it means for you now. He will explain. I cannot tell you what this means in my life. I start every day meditating on the Scriptures. Right now I'm going through Luke and 1 Timothy. I've been in Luke for over a year. You know, I used to advocate, because other people advocated it, these Bible reading plans. Read through the Bible in a year. So everybody races through it, and I came to the conclusion you could run through a grocery store and starve to death.
Hallelujah!
It isn't how much Scripture you go through, it's how much Scripture goes through you. It's how much Scripture you take in you. Sit at his feet and learn to listen to him. The other day I took my younger son off to him. He's 20. I was here 2 years ago. It was 1988. In 1989, he spent the first 6 months in a drug rehab camp, the last 6 months in a halfway house. But the other day I was off, he said, Daddy, take me to luncheon. I took him to luncheon. Then he began to tell me about what he was doing. He began to tell me about a girl he was dating. And, you know, in my opinion, she's a wipeout. I mean, I've got a lot of good reasons for it. I don't even want to give here. Since then, he has broken up with her. But you know, after talking with him about his attitude about feud, I'm talking about the last couple of months, I got uptight. And I went back to the church. And I was uptight. And started listening to Jesus. And this is what Jesus said to me. I never had this question asked me before. Jesus said to me, "Do you think my parents thought I was perfect?" And one of the things that he said to me was this. He said, "When I was about 27, they were just asking God the Father to give me a greater social life. I wasn't interested in girls." And then he went on to show me that imperfect eyes could never see perfectly. I'm telling you, to sit at his feet and listen to his word. Now, let me tell you how I visualize this. You might differ with me. I believe these five streams are like five fingers on a hand. You can do something with any one finger. See, for years, all I was an evangelical. Pull that down just a little if you would for me. All I was, no, was an evangelical. You better let God deal with the things in your life and the relationships that you have. And so, having sat at his feet and listened to his word, he can lead me into all of these. You better know when to use the gifts of the Spirit. And with whom to use the gifts of the Spirit. So I see these five streams that exist in American Christianity like the fingers and the hand together. They can make a mighty in our lives. And you see, really all these streams are aspects of Jesus. I want to ask you a question. Which stream was Jesus in? He was in all five. He'd go out and pray all night. Then he'd come out the next day and choose the 12 disciples. Hey, he would use one of his charismatic gifts with the woman at the well and say, "Hey, you've had five husbands." She'd say, "Wow." Then he'd be an evangelical and lead her to following him. Think of all the acts of mercy that Jesus did just because he had a heart of God that was good. He did acts of mercy. And those people never followed him. So he just moved from one to the other. And I'm suggesting to you that one of the ways of God today, you know what God said to me about my city? "When I look at your city, I see one church, many households." You know, we know that for God to really bless a family, a husband and wife have to be together. If a husband doesn't treat his wife right, his prayers are hindered. Because God sees them at one, they need to act like that. Well, see, in our city, we have all five of these. I think on our street, we have all five of these. And I need, right now, to be honest with you, I'm a contemplator. I'd rather spend an hour with God alone in silence than anything I know. I'd rather do that. It's the quickest hours in my life every day. When I get alone with God and just spend time with God in silence, listening to his word, I'd rather do that than anything. And my tendency, my normal tendency would be, hey, to stay locked up in that if I could do it. But see, that would make me narrow and shallow. So when I meet there, I need to do the things that God tells me. Now here's what we're going to do right now. I want you to ask God which one of these five tributaries you need added to your life right now. And I mean the next thing coming down the pike for you. And I'm going to have you stand. And your standing will be saying this: "God, as best as I know my heart, I believe that you are saying to me that the tributary that I need the most in my life right now is this one." And I'm just going to list them from one to two. And your standing up will be saying this: "God, I think I need this in my life right now. And I'm asking you to send a tributary." Now remember, when a tributary comes, it's going to change your life. It's going to change your life. There's going to be turbulence. Things are going to have to be adjusted. You can't go on living the leads the evangelical tributary of the Moselle. Would you stand? Okay, be seated. Thank you. Okay, number two, the holiness tributary. Okay, thank you. Number three, the charismatic tributary. One person. So this is two people. I mean, that's three people or four. That's a logical thing around here. There are probably four or five Baptists here that needed and afraid to stand up. But, and I understand. Listen, the first guy I ever heard talk in tongues was making an announcement, and right in the middle of his announcement, he started talking in tongues. I thought, that's the craziest thing I've ever heard in my life. I mean, that was my introduction to tongues. My introduction to healing was being in a tent meeting with an evangelist that's since been put in jail. I'm serious. And he called on me and said, come up here. I'd sat as far in the back as a Baptist preacher could sit and be hidden. And he got me on the platform. I mean, those were my introductions, you know, the swinging off the chandelier stuff, man, I tell you. I thought, well, what those guys have been saying about the charismatics is right. But it wasn't right. They were abusive. You never judge a thing by its abuse. Okay. Number four, social justice. Okay, be seated. Number five. Okay, sit down. I want to say this to you. Wherever I have preached this message, the people who stood up for number five were more than all the others put together for the other four. Now, it's going to radically alter your life to sit at Jesus' feet and listen to his word. It takes T-I-M-E. And I just want to say this, and then I want to tell you a story, and I'll be through. When you have a lifestyle that has created a rut, and when you leave this conference and go back home, you're going to be caught in that same rut, and it is going to be very difficult to break out of that rut. Let me tell you what I found the hardest thing. It's not starting something new for God, it's giving up something old that I was doing. Now, if you spend time sitting at Jesus' feet, listening to his word, as was suggested so last night, so practically, so simply, if you do that, you're going to have to give up something else. Now, if I can pass on just a suggestion, do it in the morning. I would say the Lord's Prayer is a morning prayer. When the disciples said, teach us how to pray again in the Lord's Prayer. And I'm not sure that you can pray the Lord's Prayer at night. I mean, take this. Give me this day my daily bread. Take me after this meeting. I went up and got dressed and got in bed last night. I kneeled alongside my bed and said, give me this day my daily bread. I've already eaten all day long. And then take this one. Lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from evil. I mean, I get into very few temptations after the lights are out when I'm in bed with my wife. I mean. Now, I know I'm being a little fastidious, but let me say this. Most people have found it best to do in the morning. And I want to give you one other little secret. I found the secret of getting up early in the morning. Go to bed early at night. Now I want to tell you a story. Put up scene one for me. Here's scene one. The place is a vineyard, and in the center of the vineyard there's a house. It's around 753 BC, and it's the end of a busy day. And I want you just to visualize with me the young man that owns the vineyard, sitting in a chair, having worked hard, and he's just thanking God for all of his goodness to him and his blessings to him. Right in the middle of it, God says to him, I'd like you to be my prophet. And he says, This guy's down at the grocery store buying groceries. And he sniffs. He smells the most beautiful smell. And he turns around and there's a living dog standing next to him. He's a young man, blood rises in him. She's a good-looking woman and she smells good. And he says, I got to get to know her. So he pursues her. And he wins her favor and her love. His name is Hosea. And her name is Gomer. And he marries her and takes her home. Scene number 3 for me. So the home begins to go good, and this is what happens in the home. They have 3 children. A son, a daughter, a son, and they name them this. He's a prophet, and he sees that the people of God have gone away from God, and he's a prophet, and he names his children, destruction of Israel, no compassion, not my people. And then a tragedy happens in the Hosea. Gomer has an affair. Then she has another affair. And another affair. And another affair. She finally leaves the home. Goes to have affairs out here. And Hosea's left with his 3 children. That's scene 3 now. This is scene 4. Hosea's back down at the market. He's buying groceries. And he hears a noise down at the end of the street. And he turns around and he looks and he sees a scene that he hates. But he's seen it often. They're auctioning slaves. And he spins away from it. Then he turns around because something in that scene caught his attention. And he looks. And there is his former wife being auctioned off as a slave to pay her debts. And he turns away from it with heartbreak. And God says to her, to him, go buy her back. And he's learned to obey God. So I can see him as he goes down to the auction stand. And he bids along with the bidders. And according to Hosea, he bids 15 shekels for her, which I understand is a very high price for a slave. And the auctioneer knocks it down. He says, she's yours. Now, I think this is what happened. Hosea held his hand up to Gomer and said, let's go home and build a love relationship again together. She has to decide whether she's going to go home and build a love relationship. And I can see her. She takes her hand and places it in his hand. And he leads her back home. And he loves on her. And the home changes to such a degree that they give the children new names. Jezreel is changed from destruction to bountiful harvest. Lorama is changed from no compassion to Rahama, compassion, and Loami to not my people, to my people. God has done such a miracle. God is speaking through this prophet. And what is God? God is saying to Israel, you've gone after everything but me. Will you come back home? I'm waiting to receive you. Will you come back home and let us build a loving relationship? Now this is what James said. Would you read this out loud, please? Read it. Affair with a man or woman. We have an affair with a hobby, with a set of golf clubs, with a computer, with a television set. We have taken our time away from God and our love for God, and we've gone out here and had friendships. Listen, a lot of people have had friendships with the church and religious work. Some of you go to 3 and 4 Bible studies a week, and you don't have time for God. About 4 years ago, my wife and I found out we were drifting apart. We had a very untenable situation in our home. We had two mothers that we were keeping, and this teenage son that was on drugs, didn't want anything to do with God. All four of us were living down at one end of the house in 4 bedrooms. When I didn't like it, I went down to the church to pray. I had a place to run. But my wife and I were spending less time together, that's all. There wasn't anything else involved. One day we woke up to find out, hey, we're drifting apart. And we realized that the secret of a home is that a husband and wife have the proper relationship together. And if that's not so, a home can never, ever, ever be right. So immediately we made corrections to spend time together, no matter what the cost. We realized the mothers weren't the primary importance, the teenage son wasn't the primary importance, that none of these things would work well if she and I did not have the kind of relationship that we ought to. So we just made it our business to spend time together and listen to each other. I think a lot of us have left stray. No, we haven't gone to nightclubs and X-rated movies. A lot of us have gone to Bible studies, reading books, listening to tapes. We have done everything but return to Jesus and spend time with him. And I believe what he's saying to us today is this: hey, would you come go home with me and let's build a love relationship? Will you let me love you? And let's build back that relationship that we ought to have. One thing is necessary. Mary has chosen that part. It'll not be taken from her. Most of you have admitted today that the greatest need in your life is the contemplated, meditative stream where you take time to get to know God. Let God love you. You love him. I just want to say one other thing. If you approach God as a child approaches a father, you're about to have the best time with this. Not as a worker approaches a boss, because you'll be looking for an order. Come to him as a child, to a father. Sit at his feet. I believe that's the greatest need in the church today. And if we will love him, he'll do more, far, far more for us than we ever had sense to ask. If we'll worship him, he'll work for us. Was that right? If we'll just worship him, just love him. And I think worship is just making love to Jesus and letting him make love to us. That's my understanding of worship. Okay. I've never seen anything change till people repented. And repentance means I'm wrong in what I've been doing. And by God's grace, I'm going to do what I ought to do. And in this case, it's this: I'm wrong in that I haven't chosen to give God the time, God himself the time that he needs, and that I should give him. I'm wrong. And whatever it takes, by the grace of God, I'm going to give God that. If you repent today, of this, I want you to say, now listen carefully. I want to declare to you that you're forgiven. And I want to tell you, the best description of God I know in the Father in the Bible is this. He's a father sitting on the front porch waiting for his son to come home. And when he sees him come around the bed, he runs out to meet him and throws his arms around him and takes him in the house and starts loving him with a ring and a robe and a set of shoes. So I want to tell you something. Forget those things which are behind now. Forget those things. You are forgiven. But make sure that your repentance shows up in works. And the works will be to take the time to sit at Jesus' feet and listen to his word. Father, we thank you for your abundant mercies. You've won your reputation through mercy. We thank you. We thank you that we can go back home and let you love us and love you in return. And things will be different because you'll make them different. Oh God, help us to make whatever adjustments we need to make in our hearts in this. In Jesus' name, amen.